The 800-meter run has been contested in every Olympiad since the games were revived in Athens in 1896. It is the Olympic equivalent of the half mile. Three men have won the race twice. The 800 meters is a combination of speed, tactics, strength, and endurance. The runners travel twice around the 400-meter track to the finish line. The 800 meters, a race that has produced the most dramatic finishes in Olympic history. Athletes of the world who will compete in the 10th Olympiad of the modern Olympic era.
Olympiad of the modern era.
Four years before, at the Amsterdam Games, Douglas Lowe of Great Britain made Olympic history when he became the first man to win the race twice. Lowe had previously won the 1924 Paris Olympic 800-meter gold medal. Here in Los Angeles, Great Britain will try to continue their domination of this event. British runners had won the last three 800-meter gold medals, but early in the race, Phil Edwards of Canada leads. He stays in front throughout the race, followed by his teammate Alex Wilson and Great Britain's Tom Hampson. Coming off the final turn, the two Canadians are challenged by Tom Hampson of Great Britain on the outside. Tom Hampson, Great Britain first. Alex Wilson, Canada second. Phil Edwards, Canada third. For the fourth successful Olympiad, a British runner had won the 800-meter gold medal. This is John Woodruff. He served in the United States Army during World War II and the Korean War, and ended his military career with the rank of Lieutenant Colonel. Today he spends his time coaching young athletes and officiating at local track meets near his home in New Jersey. In 1936, John Woodruff was a member of the United States Olympic team. August 1st, 1936, the opening day ceremonies of the Berlin Olympic Games. Athletes from 53 countries pass in review before Chancellor Adolf Hitler and the hierarchy of the Nazi regime. among the 383 men and women athletes on the United States team are 10 black Americans. The Nazi press referred to them as America's black auxiliaries. One of the black athletes from the United States, 21-year-old John Woodruff, a freshman at the University of Pittsburgh. For John Woodruff, the response of the German people was far different from that of the Nazi leaders and Nazi press.
The impressions were very good because the people seemed to have been very enthusiastic. They were very cordial to all the athletes. They welcomed us, you know, very enthusiastically. And a lot of people wondered about that at that particular time, but the German people really welcomed us very, very well.
Now in the nine-man 800-meter final, Woodruff would be facing two of the finest half-milers in the world, Mario Lanzi of Italy, the European champion, and Phil Edwards of Canada, closest to the camera. This will be Edwards' third Olympic attempt in the 800 meters. In 1928, he finished fourth, and in 1932, he won the bronze medal. Phil Edwards immediately goes into the lead. Woodruff on the outside moves into third place. Into the backstretch, Woodruff continues on the outside into second place, running behind Phil Edwards. Kucharski of Poland moves alongside Edwards, and now Woodruff is trapped on the inside in fourth place.
I won't have a chance of winning this race unless I get out of this box. The only way that I could get out of the box, I felt, was to slow down or stop.
Woodruff comes to almost a complete halt. Then again dashes up on the outside into the lead. It is now Woodruff, followed by Edwards and Kucharski. Edwards again takes over the lead. Woodruff second, Kucharski third. Mario Lanzi in the black shirt moves on the inside, followed by Chuck Hornbostel of the United States. Into the final turn, it is Edwards, Woodruff, Lanzi, and Kucharski. He passes Edwards and goes after Woodruff. For the first time in 24 years, a United States runner has won the 800-meter Olympic gold medal, and Great Britain's string of four successive gold medals in this event has finally been broken. After 12 years. The 1940 and 1944 games were canceled because of World War II. There is still a military atmosphere here in Wembley Stadium. King George VI is in full dress uniform as Supreme Commander of the British Armed Forces. More than 4,000 athletes from 59 countries pass in review. Two countries are noticeably absent, Germany and Japan. World War II is over but 3 years. It would be another 4 years, the 1952 Helsinki Games, before German and Japanese athletes would again compete. Many of the athletes who will compete in London are still in the armed forces. One of them is Sergeant Mal Whitfield of the United States Air Force. Whitfield is one of the co-favorites to win the 800-meter gold medal.
I was a favorite in 1948. Arthur Wint was also a favorite for the West Indies and the United Kingdom. He was a 195-pounder, 6'5", and an 11-foot stride. And of course, matching his stride against my 8-foot stride was quite a competition.
Arthur Wint, 28 years old, a pilot in the Royal Air Force during World War II. He continued his training whenever possible throughout the war. Many believe Wint is now too old and past his prime.
Well, I was hoping that if and when there was another Olympic Games, I might make it. But initially, it was the one thing I could do well, and I was determined wherever I was in the Air Force to take my running shoes along and take part in whatever competitions they were going.
The final of the 800 meters. Whitfield and Wint both easily qualify for the nine-man final. But 29-year-old Marcel Ansin of France has won both his qualifying and semifinal heats. The start of the race, Robert Chez d'Hôtel of France takes the lead. Arthur Wint immediately moves into second place, and Mal Whitfield falls behind Wint on the inside. At the halfway point, Whitfield makes his move. Chez d'Hôtel second, Arthur Wint third. Now Marcel Ansin of France quickly passes runners on the outside and moves into second place. Whitfield is first, and Sen in the black shirt second, but Wint is again coming on. Now Whitfield, United States first. Arthur Wint, Jamaica second. Marcel Ansin, France third.
On the dais, receiving my gold medal, I couldn't help but shed a few tears because this was my childhood ambition. And of course, reflecting back on the 1936 Olympic Games and seeing John Woodruff win his 800 meters, I said to myself, I too have arrived as the Olympic champion of 1948.
Helsinki, 1952. 27-year-old Sergeant Mal Whitfield has been ranked number one in the world three out of the 4 years since the 1948 London Games. In 1951, the only year he was not ranked first, he flew 27 missions as a tail gunner in a bomber during the Korean War. 32-year-old Arthur Wint is now Dr. Arthur Wint. Though he had been plagued with injuries since the London Games, here in Helsinki, he again will try to beat Mal Whitfield in the 800 meters.
I had a very limited time to prepare myself because, again, I had to pull muscle 3 weeks before the Games. So I had to get that as right as I could. I would just try and analyze the times the other boys have done, the way they ran their race, and how was I going to run against them so as to be able to win.
July 22, 1952. The final of the 800 meters. Mal Whitfield and Arthur Wint again qualify easily, but only Heinz Olzheimer of West Germany has won both his qualifying heats. Arthur Wint immediately goes into the lead. Olzheimer of Germany falls in behind him. Whitfield is back in the pack. It is evident that Arthur Wint will try a different tactic against Whitfield here in Helsinki. He will make a fast pace to try to offset Whitfield's superior finishing kick. Down the backstretch, Wint leads, closely followed by Olzheimer. Wolfsbrunn, Sweden, is third. Webster, Great Britain, fourth. And Whitfield on the outside is fifth. Into the turn for the first time, Wint leads. Olzheimer, Germany, second. Wolfsbrunn, Sweden, third. Webster, Great Britain, fourth. Whitfield, United States, fifth. For the final lap. Wint leads, followed by Olzheimer. Whitfield is third. Wolfsbrunn, Sweden, is fourth. Webster, Great Britain, fifth. With 300 meters left, it is Wint, Olzheimer, and Whitfield. There are 200 meters left. Whitfield leads, followed by Wint. Olzheimer is third. Steinus of Germany and Nielsen of Denmark share fourth place. Down the stretch, it is Whitfield, Wint, and Holzheimer. Now Whitfield first, Arthur Wint second, Heinz Holzheimer third, the time 149.2, the exact same time in which Mal Whitfield won the race at the London Games 4 years before.
He is probably one of the most cold-blooded competitors I have met. On the track, no friends, not even a kind word. Doesn't want to talk to anybody. After the event, perfect friendship. But then if you're a competitor and you're a professional, that's the way it has to be.
Mal Whitfield becomes the second man in history to win the 800 meters in successive Olympiads. In all, Whitfield won 3 gold, 1 silver, and 1 bronze medal.
It probably is one of those situations where if an athlete beats you twice, you sort of begin to develop a complex. I'm not sure what's the reason for it, but irrespective of what time the race is running, I've never beaten him in an 800 meters.
Arthur Wint's Olympic career is now over. In his 2 Olympic appearances, he won gold medals in the 400 meters in London and as part of the Jamaican 4x400 relay team here in Helsinki. But in his 2 Olympic 800 meter performances, he had to settle for the silver medal behind Mal Whitfield. This is Tom Courtney of the United States. Today he is the president of an investment counseling corporation. In 1956, as a member of the United States Army, he was rated among the finest quarter-mile and half-mile runners in the world. Melbourne, 1956, the opening day ceremonies of the Olympic Games. The 800 meters is predicted to be the most dramatic running event of the Games. The 4 men who have the best chance for a gold medal: Derek Johnson, Great Britain, Auden Boyce in Norway, Arnie Sol and Tom Courtney of the United States. Courtney is the only man to have won both his qualifying and semifinal heats.
Well, I think the heats were all right, but when I walked out for the finals, I walked out there, and I had been running for years in the nationals and the big meets, and I never used to get nervous. But I just went to pot there. I couldn't stand up. I was stretched out in the infield thinking, my gosh, here I am at the Olympics, and I'm not even going to be able to run. It got a little humorous as I thought about it, and I think that humor relieved me, and I was able to get up and go in the race.
There are 8 starters. Tom Courtney is second from the right.
We got off, and I wanted to take the lead right away because I wanted to break clear of getting into trouble in the beginning. My dad used to have a philosophy. He said if you're out in front all the way, that no one's going to bump into you. And so I took the lead the first turn, and sure enough, just as I felt he would, Sol took right over.
With less than a lap to go in the race, Arnie Sol, Courtney's teammate, leads. Auden Boyce in Norway is third. Derek Johnson, Great Britain, fourth. Ron Spurrier, United States, fifth. Mike Farrell, Great Britain, sixth. Bill Butchert, Australia, 7th. Emile Labar, Belgium, 8th. Down the backstretch the last time, Arnie Sol still leads Courtney by a yard. Boyson of Norway and Johnson, Great Britain, share 3rd place. Into the final turn, Courtney moves up to Sol's shoulder. Right behind them come Johnson and Boyson. In the stretch, Derek Johnson moves between Courtney and Sol into the lead. Tom Courtney, United States, first. Derek Johnson, Great Britain, second. Auden Boyce in Norway, third.
I didn't know that I had won. We were right at the tape, and I asked Derek after the race who won, and he said, "You did." I knew I was about to pass out. I had run myself into a state of exhaustion in doing, in a sense, the double kick at the end. But what happened was that with about 140 meters to go, Arnie Sol started his sprint. I thought to myself, you know, Arnie is crazy. He's gonna tie up, and I'm certainly not gonna go with him. And then I thought, you know, here we are at the Olympics, and maybe you get super motivation. So with about 120 meters to go, I started my sprint. Sure enough, we Wint took the lead, and I edged past Arnie just as he was starting to tie up. At that point, Derek Johnson came through on the inside and took the lead. I was tying up. I was basically finished. But I could remember in other races that there was more there if I would really force myself to do it.
Tom Courtney breaks Mal Whitfield's Olympic record by a second and a half. Never before in an Olympic 800-meter run has a leader been passed in the last 50 meters, only to come on again to win the gold medal.
My mother and dad always felt that you had an obligation to do your best, whatever you did. I've always felt that that's been true, and that I had felt that, without a question, in the Olympic race, that I had given everything that I had.
August 25th, 1960, the opening day ceremonies of the Rome Olympic Games. More than 5,000 athletes from 85 nations pass in review. Marching with the team from Belgium, 30-year-old Roger Moons. Moons is the world record holder. He has held the record for 5 years.
This would undoubtedly be my last chance to win a gold medal. I would have been the favorite to win the gold medal 4 years earlier in Melbourne, but a few months before the games, I was training on a dark rainy day in Athens. My glasses fogged up and I ran into a post supporting a tennis net and tore a muscle in my leg. Tom Courtney won the gold medal for the United States. Now, 5 years later in Rome, I was still the holder of the world record and the favorite to win.
Friday, September 2nd, the final of the 800 meters. There are six finalists. George Kerr, representing the West Indies, has won his three qualifying heats. He is expected to give Roger Moons his strongest opposition. After winning his first two heats, Roger Moons is defeated by Peter Snell of New Zealand in the semifinal.
I considered myself rather fortunate to be in the team because my time was something like 25th in the world that year in 800 meters. I was expected to perhaps make the final in the 800, but nothing more than that.
Peter Snell's victory in the semifinal did not upset me. I thought it was a fluke, and I did not consider Snell a threat in the final. The man I feared was George Kerr of the West Indies.
With 500 meters to go, Christian Vagli of Switzerland leads, Paul Schmidt, Germany second, Kerr third, Snell fourth, Munz fifth. The bell for the last lap. Vagli leads, followed by Schmidt. Kerr is third, Snell fourth, Munz fifth, and Manfred Matuszewski, Germany, last. Down the backstretch for the last time, Vagli leads. Snell in the all-black uniform is fourth. Roger Moons alongside Snell makes his move. Quickly, he goes into second place. Schmidt, Kerr, and Snell are right behind.
I said, I can't make this move now. I will just stay on the inside. There was a number of other runners that were all starting to spread out across the track. And I stayed this way right around the final curve. A gap opened, and then suddenly I saw Roger Moons out on the right-hand side of the track, and I thought, gee, I can perhaps win this.
Peter Snell first, Roger Moons second, George Kerr third. Snell breaks Tom Courtney's Olympic record by 1 4/10 seconds, but is still 0.6 seconds off the world record. Roger Moons still holds the world record, but here in Rome, his chances for an Olympic gold medal are over.
I took the lead from Vagli on the final turn. As I passed him, I closed my eyes and said to myself, I am the Olympic champion. I gave everything I had down the stretch. I looked to my right and did not see George Kerr, whom I feared. I closed my eyes again and said to myself, Roger, this time it is certain you are the Olympic champion. A black uniform flashed by me. It was Peter Snell.
Later, the victory platform ceremony takes place. Peter Snell stands on the top step, flanked by Roger Munns and George Kerr. For the first time in 24 years, a runner from New Zealand has won an Olympic gold medal. Tokyo, 1964. Peter Snell is named to carry the New Zealand flag in the opening day ceremonies. In the 4 years since the Rome Games, he has become the finest half-miler and miler in the world. Here in Tokyo, he will attempt to win both the 800 and 1500 meters, a feat that has been accomplished only three times before in Olympic history.
Prior to Tokyo, thoughts of retirement, of course, had entered my head, and I decided that for my last effort, the possibility of doing a double was very much to the forefront of my mind. I knew that that given good preparation, that there was no one currently on the scene that would be capable of beating me, certainly at 1,500 meters.
Peter Snell is correct. Coming off the final turn in the 800 meters, Snell again unleashes his tremendous finishing kick. Peter Snell first, Bill Crothers, Canada second, Wilson Kiprigat, Kenya third. Peter Snell breaks his own Olympic record by 1 2/10 seconds. A few days later, the final of the 1500 meters. The two New Zealanders, Peter Snell and John Davies, are in the all-black uniforms. The two men who will battle it out in the 1500 meters 4 years later in Mexico City are eliminated in the qualifying heats. Kip Kano of Kenya and Jim Ryan of the United States. With a little more than a lap to go, John Davies of New Zealand leads. Peter Snell is right behind him in second place. But now several runners in a tightly bunched field move alongside Snell. Snell is trapped on the inside.
When I realized that I couldn't get out of this box, it caused a little bit of panic that I could find myself out of it as a result of bad positioning. And I was determined not to let it happen. And so as an initial gesture, I put out my arm. I saw that it was John Wetton alongside me in his English, all-white English vest. And I felt that maybe I sort of gently nudged him just to give him an idea that more would come if he didn't move. He was the perfect gentleman and obligingly moved aside.
Snell is now clear and moves to the outside. Snell, New Zealand first. Joseph Odlozil, Czechoslovakia second. John Davies, New Zealand third. Peter Snell's Olympic career is now over. Two 800-meter gold medals, one 1,500-meter gold medal. One of the great middle-distance performances in Olympic history. October 15, 1968. The place, Mexico City. One of the two favorites to win the 800 meters is Wilson Kiprigat of Kenya. Kiprigat won the bronze medal 4 years before in Tokyo. The other favorite, number 105, Ralph Dubell of Australia, who will attempt to become the first Australian to win the 800 meters since Edwin Flack won the event 72 years before in Athens. Leading up to the games, Dubell has been plagued with injuries. His coach, Franz Stampel,
on the plane, his foot puffed up to enormous proportions. And he thought, well, this is it. You know, I've had it. He came into Mexico City, and within a day, the whole lot disappeared. The swelling, the pain, everything is gone.
I tried on spikes about 3 weeks before I left and ran a number of good time trials. And I was fit as I thought I could be. And then once I got to Mexico, my training there was excellent, and I felt good.
Tom Farrell of the United States is in lane 8 on the far outside. Beside Farrell in lane 7 is Dieter Frum of East Germany. In lane 6 is Wilson Kiprigat of Kenya. In the semifinal, Dubell defeated Kiprigat by a tenth of a second. Kiprigat immediately goes into the lead, followed by Benedict Cayenne representing Trinidad Tobago. They stay that way through the stretch for the first time around. With a little more than 400 meters to go, it is Kiprigat in the lead, followed by Cayenne. Frum of East Germany is third and Dubell fourth on the outside. Around the turn and into the backstretch, Kiprigat remains in front. Dubell moves from fourth to second. Down the backstretch for the last time, it is still Kiprigat, Kenya first, Ralph Dubell, Australia second. Kiprigat is first into the final turn, followed by Dubell. Dubell, Australia first. Kiprigat, Kenya second. Farrell, United States third.
Kiprigat was really tough to get past. I think it took 50 yards in the first 50 yards of the straight. I was still yelling to myself, you know, push, push, go harder and go harder. And then the break comes and you feel it and you just break contact. It may only be a foot or 2 feet. I knew I was past and I knew I'd broken contact and I didn't think I could lose it then. So I started, you know, just yelling to myself, you know, I've won it. You cross the line and say, well, that's nice, I've won it. And you sort of stand around wondering what to do next. I saw the time, and it was 1:44.3, and I asked Tom Farrell, who came third, what the world record was. And he said, that's it. I said, well, that's nice.
Ralph Dubell stands on the top step of the victory platform. He becomes the first Australian in 72 years to win the 800-meter gold medal. This is Bethany College, West Virginia. This is Dave Wattle, the Bethany track coach. In the year 1970, Wattle finished second in the NCAA championship mile race, finishing behind Marty LaQuarrie, one of America's outstanding milers.
I was a sophomore in college, and I ran a 3:59 mile at the national meet. And I said, well, geez, I'm only 2 years away from the Olympic Games. You know, maybe I have a chance at fulfilling a big goal in my life, you know, and getting to the Olympic Games. It was a very hard time for me because I would get an injury, and I kept my positive thinking going, and then all of a sudden another injury would come and it would lay me back, and then another one. I had three back-to-back injuries, and the third one just about broke me, you know, and it got to the point where my father will never admit it, but I can remember him saying that, you know, that I should probably give it up and hang up my spikes and just stop running.
Munich, 1972, the opening day ceremonies of the Olympic Games. Marching with the United States team, 22-year-old Dave Wattle. Wattle won the 800-meter United States Olympic trials. Just before the United States team was to leave for Munich, Dave Wattle again had trouble with his leg.
I came down with tendonitis in my left knee, and it lasted for 3 weeks. Really downhearted, and I really believe now, looking back, that I would have probably turned around and gone home if my wife hadn't been there. I was just married like 2 weeks before I had left on the Olympic trip.
In his semifinal heat, Dave Wattle, wearing a baseball cap, is in danger of not making it to the finals. The runners who place first and second in each of the three semifinals, as well as the two fastest non-placers, qualify. Coming off the final turn, Wattle is in fourth. Dave Wattle wins, but his time is by far the slowest of the three semifinal winners. The next day, the 800-meter final. The favorite in the race, Yevgeny Arzhanov of the Soviet Union, who is unbeaten in 3 years. Dave Wattle is in lane three.
Well, I felt a little unsure, mainly because of my injury. I still went into the races a little unsure of my own capabilities. The names didn't scare me at all, because I've always just felt, hey, you're as good as anybody. Don't let them psych you out that Arzhanov's undefeated in 3 years, heavy favored, you know. And I would just discount that from my mind. All I ever really cared about was how I felt in the race.
The two Kenyans in the green shorts, Mike Boyd second from the right, and Robert Owuku fifth from the right, are out fastest of all. Boyd and Owuku have both won their qualifying and semifinal heats. Arzhanov of the Soviet Union, closest to the camera in the red shirt, trips and falls back to sixth. Dave Wattle trails in eighth place.
Oh, I felt so lousy. I felt I went out so slow, and I had all these butterflies. I was so nervous, you know. I couldn't believe it. I hadn't been that nervous since like the state high school meet, you know, when I almost wanted just to walk off the track before it started. And I just couldn't get the butterflies out. And I was just thinking, oh, how disgraceful. You know, I mean, you're going to go home and all your friends are going to look at you and you're going to have placed dead last on worldwide television, and you're just going to be a disgrace. And all I wanted to do was get back up to the pack and make it look respectable.
At the halfway point, Mike Boyd of Kenya leads, followed by his teammate Robert Owuku. Carter, Great Britain, is third on the outside. From East Germany, fourth. Kupchik, Poland, fifth. Arzhanov, Soviet Union, sixth. Kemper, West Germany, seventh. Wattle, eighth and last. Down the backstretch, Arzhanov in the red shirt makes his move. Boyd of Kenya and From of East Germany go after him. Dave Wattle has moved into sixth place. Now Robert Owuku of Kenya on the inside moves into contention. Wattle passes runners on the outside and moves into fourth. Into the stretch, there's Arzhanov, followed by the two Kenyans. Dave Wattle is coming on. From the stands, it is not apparent who has won.
I raised my arms because I felt that I had won the race. And mainly because when you cross a finish line, you can sense the other person there. And I sensed no one there, so I thought that I had won the race. And it looked like, I think, probably on TV, that I was dazed, that I didn't know what I had done. I think I knew that what I had done, but I didn't know if I had won. And I just stood there waiting, and no one talked to me, and I didn't talk to anybody. You know, it just seemed like eternity, and then it finally flashed up, you know, and it was a tremendous amount of relief.
Dave Wattle, United States first. Yevgeny Arzhanov, Soviet Union second. Mike Boyd, Kenya third.
I started my kick with about 180 meters out from the finish, my all-out kick. And when I hit the top of the home stretch, I was simply going after a bronze medal. I wasn't even going after the gold or silver. Then once I passed Uku, I was going after, you know, the silver medal. You know, you quickly reevaluate your goals. Maybe you might as well go after a silver now. And then I really wasn't going after the gold, really driving for the gold or realizing that I could get it until about 3 meters to the finish line, because it was just so close with Arzhanov and myself and he's really started to falter right near the end. He started his kick way too soon. I think he sensed that I came up on his shoulders, and he tried to re-accelerate, and that's when he fell.
Dave Waddle has given Yevgeny Arzhenov of the Soviet Union his first loss in a final in 3 years. Both Waddle and Arzhenov are officially given the exact same finishing time.
I was proud to be, you know, a citizen of the United States. I really was. I really felt that I achieved what I did, or one of the things that enabled me to achieve it was the fact that I was a citizen of this country. And I was just proud of the accomplishment. You know, I couldn't believe, you know, it was the highest award you could possibly win in track and field. And, you know, here I am, a little hick from Canton, Ohio, and a 420 miler in high school, and I was able to win the gold medal. It was just a very pleasing moment for me.
The victory platform ceremony takes place. Dave Waddle is flanked by Arzhenov and Boyd as the national anthem is played. In his excitement, Dave Waddle has forgotten to remove his hat.
You know, I've run so many workouts in the hat, and I ran the race. I really didn't know it was on. It really hurt me, the fact that, you know, that I left my hat on, because I didn't mean any disrespect. It's such an emotional time. You're exhausted, you just ran a race, you're feeling really good, and then all of a sudden the bombshell hits you. And that's when it really hit me, you know, hey, Jesus, I don't believe I did that, you know.
Soon after the platform ceremony, Dave Waddle is greeted by his mother.
The thing I can remember here, her son had won a gold medal. And the first thing she told me, she reminded me why I didn't take my hat off. And she says, oh, that's so terrible that you didn't take your hat off on the victory stand. You know, she doesn't congratulate me for winning. You know, why didn't you take off your hat?
Dave Waddle of the United States, the 1972 winner of the Olympic 800-meter gold medal. Montreal, 1976. The nations of the world march in the opening day ceremonies of the 21st Olympiad of the modern era. Many of the African nations have boycotted the games over political issues. Because of the boycott, Mike Boyd of Kenya, one of the pre-race favorites in the 800 meters, will not compete. Boyd out of the competition, Rick Walhooter of the United States and Ivo Van Damme of Belgium are now the favorites. After the heats and semifinals are completed, a third favorite emerges. He is Alberto Huantarena of Cuba. Before the games, Huantarena was picked by most to win the gold medal in the 400 meters, which will be run 4 days after the 800 meters.
2 months before the Montreal Games, my coaches advised me to run the 800 meters in order to build up my strength to run the 400 meters. My times for the 800 meters were very fast, and so it was decided that I would run in both races.
Huantarena and Walhooter both win their qualifying and semifinal heats. Walhooter has run the fastest qualifying time, but Huantarena has turned in the second fastest time of the eight finalists. The first part of the race will be run in staggered lanes. The eight finalists line up. Rick Walhooter is in lane 3, third from the left. Ivo Van Damme is fourth from the left. And Alberto Huantarena, fifth from the left in lane 5. They will run in lanes until they come into the stretch for the completion of the first 400 meters. With 500 meters to go, Huantarena leads, followed by Walhooter. On the outside, Singh of India in the blue uniform moves in front of Huantarena on the turn and takes over first place. Huantarena second, Walhooter third. Just as quickly, Huantarena takes the lead back. Walhooter goes right after him, and Van Damme on the outside goes past Singh into third place. Down the backstretch, it is Huantarena, Walhooter, and Van Damme. Into the final turn, Walhooter moves up on Huantarena. Van Damme is third. Alberto Fontarena, Cuba, first. Ivo Van Damme, Belgium, second. Rick Walhooter, United States, third. Alberto Fontarena sets a new world record and becomes the first runner from a non-English-speaking country to win the Olympic 800-meter run. There is still another honor for Alberto Fontarena. It is the first time in Olympic history that a Cuban athlete has won a gold medal in track and field.
Winning the 800 meters brought me great satisfaction. I was happy to break the world record, but my greatest happiness was for my country. In Cuba, we do not run for ourselves. We run for all our countrymen who have made it possible for us to compete.
The day after his victory in the 800 meters, the heats and quarterfinals of the 400 meters are scheduled. In the morning qualifying round, Fontarena finishes third in his heat and moves into the quarterfinals the same afternoon. Fontarena finishes second in his quarterfinal heat. 2 days later in the semifinals, Fontarena wins his section, but Fred Newhouse of the United States wins his third successive race and is the fastest qualifier of the eight finalists. Two other United States runners make it to the final, Herman Frazier and Maxie Parks. The eight men line up for the final. The men to watch, Fontarena in lane two, second from the left, and the two Americans, Herman Frazier and Fred Newhouse, to Wantarena's right in lanes three and four. They will run in lanes throughout the entire race. Because of the staggered lanes, it is difficult to see who is in front. But down the backstretch, Newhouse, second from the right, is running fastest of all. On the extreme right, Herman Frazier is second. Fontarena, just coming into the picture on the right, goes after Frazier and Newhouse. In the middle of the turn, Fontarena catches Frazier, but Newhouse is still 3 meters in front. Alberto Fontarena, Cuba, first. Fred Newhouse, United States, second. Herman Frazier, United States, third. Alberto Fontarena has performed a feat never before accomplished in Olympic history. He has won both the 800-meter and 400-meter gold medals. In winning the 400 meters, he has run the third fastest race in history. 40 hundredths of a second over the world record. He has also created a world record in the 800-meter run. Even more, in the history of the Olympic Games, Cuba has won two gold medals in track and field competition.